This morning, with rising crime a concern across the country, city lawmakers in Washington, D.C. are set to vote on what's being called an emergency public safety bill to address soaring crime rates.
In a shocking development, just 4 months after they actually voted to weaken some of the public safety laws in Washington, D.C., the same D.C. council members are now pushing an emergency public safety bill to address a sharp increase in violent crime. Now, the emergency legislation came after a violent long weekend in the district with 4 fatal shootings on the July 4th holiday alone. 9 people were wounded by gunfire at a single July 4th celebration in Northeast DC. The youngest victim was just 10 years old. Police say all are expected to survive the shooting. Now, the council member who is really pushing this emergency legislation, her name is Brooke Pinto. She chairs the council's Judiciary and Public Safety Committee, and she told reporters this, quote, "We are in a state of emergency right now. And like in any emergency, we have to act like it. And we have to act urgently as a government to address the problem that we're seeing." Now, how bad is the crime in Washington, D.C.? Well, let's take a look at the next video and then I'll give you more details.
Violent crimes in D.C. are up 33% in the last year. Murders are up 17%.
When we have members of our community being shot and killed at rates that we haven't seen for 20 years, that's an emergency, period.
The emergency bill would make it harder to release suspects accused of a violent crime before trial, whether they're an adult or juvenile, and whether or not they are armed. Supporters point to this statistic, saying right now, a typical murder suspect in D.C. has already been arrested 11 times for previous crimes.
I think that we're going to be safer because people who are committing violent crime won't be on the street to commit more violent crime.
The bill would also create a new criminal offense called endangerment with a firearm, making it a felony to fire a gun in public, and it would increase the penalties for illegal gun possession.
Now, if you look at the specific statistics and the specific crimes, there is, in fact, evidence indicating that there is a sharp increase in some of these violent crimes. So let's take a look at the data that was put out comparing 2022 to 2023. And remember, we're not even halfway done with the year yet, right? So you can see that homicides did in fact increase 17%. Sex abuse increased 35% compared to 2022. Robbery increased 52% compared to last year. And overall violent crime has increased or jumped 33% compared to 2022. And then there are the what's described as nonviolent crimes that has also experienced a sharp incline or increase, I should say, compared to 2022. And so council member Pinto told reporters that within the first 3 months of 2023, the city had over 100 cases where people were charged with a crime of violence, released pretrial, and recommitted another violent offense. I should note that they did bail reform in DC in 1990. So it's not that they had actually succeeded in weakening public safety laws in DC, because 4 months ago when they tried to pass legislation that some described as weakening public safety laws, Congress got involved and scrapped it. And so they haven't really done anything, you know, that could be pinned on loosening laws or being laxed about criminal justice. But in this case, they're seeing a sharp increase and they think that they need to respond to it. Now, I want to give you one quote, Cenk, and then I'll go to you. So 4 months ago, as I mentioned, they wanted to do criminal justice reform in DC. Congress squashed it. So at the time, there was a particular council member who was furious about that. But here's what he's saying today. Council Chairman Phil Mendelson reversed an earlier assessment he gave Congress during testimony at a March hearing about DC's public safety. Criminals, he said on Monday, can get away with murder in this city.
Wow. Well, that is an abrupt change of mind. And that happens, by the way. You know why that happens sometimes? Facts. When you see crime running out of control and it's not anecdotal and you see it in the numbers, and car thefts are up 117% and robberies are up 52% and homicides are way up, etc. Well, you go, okay, then I guess I've got to change my opinion based on the facts. By the way, that's the way it's supposed to be. You're not supposed to change the facts based on your opinions. You're supposed to change your opinions based on the facts. So credit to Phil Mendelson for doing that then. So now, what changed? Well, that's a bit of a mystery. There's one answer as to what changed, and that's the number of cops. We'll come back to that in a second. But the laws didn't change much, as Anna pointed out. One changed in 1990, and the other laws are from 1901, right? Mm-hmm. So just be careful about, like, no, there wasn't some sort of, like, the right wing will say, oh, you see criminal justice reform, but they didn't do criminal justice reform here. Now, on the other hand, they have decided we got to keep more people in pretrial detention. And so some on the left will be very upset. Not will be, they are very upset about that. And a lot of the activists in Washington are upset about that. But one of the reasons they're doing that is they're adjusting the facts. And that fact that we showed you there is a critical one. That people are coming back and doing 11 extra crimes when they are released. Why? Because this is a giant thing that was underestimated, honestly, by our side, including me, okay? Which is that the number, generally speaking, the number one issue in crime is repeat offenders. And they do an enormous percentage of the crime. And so when you don't have pretrial detention, there's good reasons to get rid of pretrial detention for lower level crimes. But there's a second problem that that creates, which I'll tell you in a second. But when you get rid of pretrial detention for too many crimes, a lot of serious crimes are committed, they go right back on the street, and they don't think, oh, well, I'm gonna come and have to serve me justice 6 months from now when the trial happens. They think, oh, I got out of jail for doing this crime, it's totally okay. You think, oh, people don't really think that way. No, maybe you don't think that way, but these repeat offenders definitely think that way, and they show it, right? And then finally, in terms of the issues, misdemeanors. A lot of the misdemeanors shouldn't be misdemeanors. So now,
yeah, they're violent crimes.
Because like, they're violent crimes.
Like strangulation.
Exactly.
Strangulation is a violent act. You're putting your hands on someone, you're putting your hands around someone's neck. Like look, that's what they did in California, right? So when there was a ballot initiative in order to, you know, make some or push for reforms in regard to nonviolent crimes, I voted in favor of that. But then they decided to reclassify all sorts of violent crimes, including human trafficking, including strangulation and domestic violence as nonviolent crimes.
Yeah, it makes no sense.
Insane.
So look, by the way, that's not the left's fault in its entirety. Some activists unfortunately do think that that's rational, but the majority.
Let someone strangle you and let's see how you feel about it. Yeah. I would venture to say you would think that's a violent act and you would feel threatened by the violent act and you would want to keep that person away from you and the general public so they don't harm others.
But the great majority of Democrats and the left do not share that opinion. And when they see how this has been carried out in some places and they see crime rising, they go, no, wait. No, strangulation should not be a misdemeanor, right? Some of these super serious crimes, and each jurisdiction differs. California, New York, DC, they all have slightly different laws and slightly different classifications for misdemeanors and felonies. But in a lot of these major cities, tons of things that you would never think is a misdemeanor, you would think it's a felony because it's so violent, are misdemeanors. And when those people were starting to get a lot less sentences and they're not being held pre-trial and they're committing crimes over and over again, that's part of what piled up. And then Democratic voters were like, no, no. In Portland, they're like gone. San Francisco, no, thank you to these kind of laws, etc. And it happened in New York and now in DC. DC is a little bit different situation as we explained here, but basically the voters are telling their Democratic councilman and mayor, turn around, crime is too high.
Yeah, and look, I wanna tell you more of what they're trying to do. So the mayor of DC, Muriel Bowser, had a proposal, and apparently the proposal led to some backlash among activists. And so what Pinto decided to do was pursue an emergency bill, and emergency bills pass differently in the council, okay? So they don't need to basically go through the vote two times. There are far less obstacles. They do a one-time vote and you know, the 9 council members vote on it once, and if it passes, it passes, right? So that's the emergency bill. And what Pinto did here was do away with some of the more contentious or controversial elements of Mayor Bowser's proposal. And so I wanna tell you what Pinto's emergency bill entails. So the bill would still tilt, this is graphic eight, the law in favor of more pretrial detention for youth accused of dangerous or violent crimes, whether or not they were armed. But it keeps some exceptions for drug-related crimes and burglaries that don't involve real or imitation guns. It also strikes the particularly controversial Bowser proposal that would allow judges to detain kids for their own protection, regardless of whether they presented a danger to the public. I can't even believe that Bowser proposed that. I'm very happy to see that Pinto took that out of the emergency bill.
So that's a Democratic mayor that proposed something so draconian that other Democrats and people on the left were like, no, too much.
Right.
Too much. And we agree, it's too much. Okay. So you've got to find the right balance. I know extremists on both sides say, no, there should be no balance. There should only be radical options, right? No, the answer is in the balance. And your voters, your left-wing voters, are telling you that.
So the emergency bill would expand protections for children who have experienced child abuse and allow contractors and consultants who have access to schools to be prosecuted for sexual abuse. I think everyone agrees that that's a good thing. Create a new offense for firing a gun in public. I think everyone will agree that that's a good thing, right?
Yeah,
I mean, we can't have people
in the middle of a city. Are you crazy? How is that not against the law?
Make it easier for prosecutors to extradite people for misdemeanors and use GPS data from ankle monitors to prove people's guilt in court. Add strangulation to the definition of a crime of violence in the DC code, which I think makes a lot of sense. And finally, require the city's criminal justice coordinating council to publicly share more data on the outcomes of diversion programs that offer services instead of traditional prosecution. I would absolutely love for them to do that. I think it's important for us to get that data to see whether or not the diversion programs are being implemented properly, whether they're effective, whether if they are effective, they should be more widespread throughout the country. That data is important, and I've been really, really wanting to see that data for a while. So I love that that's part of this emergency bill as well.
100%. To me, like, that's almost the most important part. Because I don't know ahead of time if they're gonna work or not. I know ideologues on both sides are positive. They don't need any stinking data, right? But for me, if the diversion programs are working, if different things we're trying other than policing is working, great. If it isn't working, okay, then we have to go to a different direction. If you believe in just orthodox ideology, you don't care about the facts.
Yeah.
You go, no, this is what I want, and I don't wanna know whether it's working or not, right? Well, I do, sorry. And so sorry that I'm rational. So please tell us if these programs are working. If they are, let's do more. If they're not, then let's do less.
And finally, look, even if this emergency bill passes, there's one major problem in DC, and this problem is shared among many big cities across the country. There's a pretty severe shortage of police, and Bowser is kind of panicking about it. They're offering $20,000 bonuses to new police recruits.
Now 25,000, they cranked it up.
So they're having difficulty attracting people to work as cops, and it's following, you know, what happened in 2020. People know how unpopular it is to be a police officer, and so there were a lot of early retirements following the 2020 protests. And then after that, it was just difficult to get new recruits. The size of the DC police force has shrunk to a half century low as officers leave faster than they can be replaced. Despite some hiring in the past year, the force has just over 3,350 sworn officers at the end of March, a net loss of about 450 over the past 3 years. Police Chief Robert Conti said he expected the size of the force could fall to about 3,130 by the end of fiscal year 2024. So that is a problem, and what they're doing now is having these cops work mandatory overtime shifts. That's not a system that's gonna work out so well, in my opinion.
And we overpay when they do overtime. So look, guys, this one's also nuanced. So for the guys taking early retirements, actually, I'm happy about that. Now there's less cops on the street, but these are the guys who are the biggest belly achers about, now I gotta follow the Constitution, now I can't beat people up, now I have to do my job, I'm retiring early, I don't like it. Good, I want you to retire early, go. But we have to replace them, okay? So now if you did a program where you said, all right, we're gonna cut the number of cops we have. And Washington did stop spending on hiring new cops. You have to have an alternative. And then you have to tell us, did the alternative work, right? But right now, I didn't see an alternative in Washington. And just stopping the money to the cops without saying, okay, let's redirect the money to X, Y, or Z, right? Well, that's a terrible plan. And so now a lot of the council members are saying, and this is not definitive, but it's an important data point. Look, here's when we had more cops and we had less crime. Here's now when we have less cops and we have more crime. But that's not surprising. If you don't do the alternative, yeah, of course you're gonna get these results. Like, there is no fantasy land where there's less law enforcement, less social services, less everything, and somehow you have less crime. That's not a thing, right? So give me an alternative, and for God's sake, test it and give us data back on it. Otherwise, go hire some cops and make sure they actually follow the law and do their job right. It's not too much to ask for. Thanks for watching The Young Turks, really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.